Okay, so we're gonna start. Hello everyone, and thank you for being here today. So my name is Tatiana Abu Murad. I am finishing my second year of medical school at the American University of Beirut, and I am also part of LAMSA, so I'm a LAMSA ambassador, and I'm gonna be talking about LAMSA in a few. But basically today we're going to be talking about ecstasy. So the title of the topic is The Battle of Rave, and we're gonna see why I chose this topic later on. But basically, I want you guys to know that we're talking about a drug that is highly used and is one of the most used drugs by the teenagers and young adults. So it's really important for the young adults and teenagers that are with us today to know about its effects and side effects, and for the parents or caregivers to know about it as well. So I'm gonna please ask you guys to mute your mics. If you have any kind of question, you can leave them till the end, or you can write in the chat, I'll read it later. So for the newcomers, what is LAMSA? So LAMSA is short for the Lebanese Association of Medical Services for Adolescents. It's basically a non-governmental organization that aims to raise awareness about mental health and discuss these topics, as they are very, very important nowadays. So it's basically youth empowering youth, as it is a medical student-run NGO. So, what is ecstasy? Ecstasy stands for MDMA, which is short for 3,4-methylenedioxymethamphetamine. So I'm going to be talking about MDMA because it's a bit easier. Basically, it is also known as ecstasy or Molly. It is an illegal drug. It is a synthetic. What I mean by synthetic is that it is not synthesized, so it's not a natural drug. It's in the lab, and it's basically derived from amphetamine. It is both a stimulant and hallucinogenic, so it can stimulate you while also produce distortion of time and perception. And we're going to talk about this later on also. And one of the main problems about ecstasy is that it is very easily obtained. So people can use it super easily. So basically, MDMA was initially developed to control bleeding, and also psychologists or psychotherapists believe that it would help them in psychotherapy. However, it became very popular in the 80s in like music festivals and rave parties. I mean by raves are the weekend-long parties such as Tomorrowland, for example. In 1985, it was scheduled as a, it named as a Schedule I drugs by the Drug Enforcement Administration. And basically, a Schedule I drug is a drug that is not used for a medical condition and which has a high potential for abuse. So basically, after all of this, it still appears to be very popular among and it has widespread use among young people under the age of 25. So it's very popular among teens and young adults who go to clubs, concerts, etc. And also in a recent study, it was found that among eighth graders, 1.7% have already used it in their lifetime, 2.6 among 10th graders, and 3.6 among 12th graders. So this shows how much it's really used by adolescents. So what does it look like? It is very helpful to know what the most common forms of ecstasy look like, particularly because if someone offers it to you, so you would know. And also if you're a parent or a caregiver of a child or a teenager, so you would type of drugs they're exposed to. It has a very huge variation in its appearance, and this is basically because people use different ingredients to produce a pill out of it. And this is basically one of the worst things about is you can never really know what the drug is made of, and we'll talk about this later on. But the most common form is that they come as small colored tablets. So basically, they have a bright color, and this makes it more appealing, especially to young people, because like it looks like a candy, and also it can come as a logo or a cartoon character. So, for example, there are some forms of it as SpongeBob, The Simpsons, Obama, Ninja Turtles, etc. And this is very dangerous because, like, if a child is walking on the street and they find one of it, one of like the pills, it's very easy for them to grab it and taste it. So this was one of the ways to make the pill and promote a dangerous drug as a really fun drug. So how is it used? Usually, the most common form is used like they swallow the pill, the tablet, and it's also used as a powder. It usually has a bitter taste. So what happens is that usually in parties, there are some people going around. There's a common thing that like you put your tongue out and would pull the pill on your tongue and you would swallow it. And there are different versions of this drug. So I talked about it later. I talked about it before, but there are many names of this drug. So it can be called X or Seven, Adam, hug drug or love drug, and we'll see why it's called a hug or a love drug. And as I said before, one of the most dangerous things about it is that it is really very easily obtained. So this is one of the most common drugs that is sold on the streets. So how does it work? Usually, this drug it makes you feel high. So it's both a stimulant and a hallucinogen. So it stimulates you while also producing distortion of time and perception. It boosts the activity of three brain chemicals, which are the neurotransmitters serotonin, dopamine, and norepinephrine, which play all a role in mood, energy level, sexual activity, emotions, and sleep. So, what do users feel? Usually, there's a common saying that the MDMA makes you feel MDMAzing. And it's very true because users have a sense of euphoria and happiness and warmth. And it is used in rave, etc., is because people think that the more you use it, the more it keeps you going without rest. So you have feelings that are much more intense, and you have a heightened sensation of touch, sound, and smell. So you feel uninhibited. And that's mainly why psychiatrists, before that, psychiatrists used to think that it was good for therapy. That's mainly why, because it lowered the patient's inhibition and allowed them to be more open and honest. But it's not true. So basically, the effects start within 30 minutes. They can last up to 6 hours, and they are detectable in the urine for up to 4 days. But all of these depend on the dose that you take, your body mass, etc. So what are the main side effects? So as we said, it's a stimulant, so it's going to increase your heart rate. And you know that I said that it's basically taken when you're dancing and at festivals, etc. So this is really a problem because it increases your heart rate alone, but you're also dancing and you're engaging in physical activity, so you're doubly increasing your heart rate. And this could aggravate like any kind of condition, cardiovascular condition that you may already suffer from. And you also can have a rapid breathing, rapid eye movement, and blurred vision, which are all exaggerated by the lightning in the parties. You can also have a dry mouth because it causes dehydration. And so the people would think that they would want to like drink water. And in parties, if you can't have access to water, you would drink alcohol. And the problem with it is that alcohol makes you even more dehydrated, and there's a huge drug-drug interaction that we're going to talk about also. One of the main symptoms of it is teeth and jaw clenching, so your jaw it would move. You have urine retention, chills, no, sweat, nausea. You feel that you're paranoid, so you would feel that someone is like plotting against you or they want to kill you. And there are also a lot of drug-drug interaction that could be because you're mixing it with alcohol, cigarette smoking, or any other type of drug that you already took, for example, for like head pain or any something else. And one of the side effects is hyperthermia. So basically, as I said, you're in a party, you're dancing, it's overcrowded. So the thing that happens is that MDMA limits your body's ability to regulate this increase in body temperature. And this could be very, very dangerous because it leads to muscle breakdown, kidney, liver, and heart damage, as well as death. Also, another problem is that I talked to you before about MDMA lessening your inhibition, so you feel uninhibited. And I said that it's called the love drug or the hug drug, and this is because it increases your feelings of warmth. So you're more likely to engage in unsafe sexual activity and to get sexually transmitted diseases like hepatitis and HIV, and more likely to inject yourself with a dirty needle, which is also very dangerous. Some other side effects. So basically, I said before that it uses your serotonin neurotransmitter. So a couple of days after, you're going to have a depletion of serotonin and you won't be able to achieve the same level of happiness that you had before. And this can lead to negative behavioral after effects and a depressed mood. And this is why we talk about a suicide Tuesday, basically because people go on parties during the weekend. And a couple of days after, they would experience depression symptoms. So this is why it's called like that. People can also suffer from sleep disturbances such as insomnia, anxiety, and impairs a lot of mental abilities such as concentration, memory, and judgment. And this shows how it is really very dangerous to drink after you use it. And it's the same thing with all other types. On the long term, it has also some long-term effects. So it causes brain damage, especially to the areas that of the brains that are important for thinking and memory. And it can also disrupt the serotonin nerve terminals. You lose pleasure in sexual activity, you have sleep disturbances, and it can also increase your aggression and irritability. However, all of these are not the most important side effects. Actually, I told you before that the problem about ecstasy is that you can never know what you are taking. And this is because this type of substance is highly mixed with other drugs such as cocaine, LSD, and bath salts. So basically, bath salts are the fake cocaine. And the problem with that is that people that take ecstasy are not prepared for its effect. So they think that it's only going to be a feeling of euphoria and it's going to pass and it's done. But actually, they start feeling a lot of symptoms that they're not prepared for, and this could lead to severe panic attacks. And actually, a recent study that there were some researchers that studied, like they examined the tablets of ecstasy, and they found that only 60% contained any MDMA at all. So there were 40% that didn't even contain MDMA. And among those, 25% had unknown substances. So the researchers couldn't even know what was inside those tablets. And one thing that we need to know is the shape tablets. So I talked to you before about the ones that look like SpongeBob and Obama. These are much more dangerous than the flat ones. So this led a lot of researchers to suggest that offering a one pill, offering a non-site pill testing at stations like concerts or any other event where ecstasy is highly used might reduce the risks to users. However, it seemed a bit weird to people because some believe that, okay, if someone comes to me with, for example, an ecstasy pill, I won't tell him, oh, let me check if it's pure. Before you take it, I will take it away from him or her. Other people think that no, it's better to build a trust relationship, and both cases they're consuming it anyway, so better for them consume something that's pure than something that is not. And this is very still debatable, and I would love to have your opinion on that matter. If you can write it on the chat, or we can talk about it at the end also. And so we're talking the safe use, to talk about this. So it's really important to know how much you are taking, because it is known that higher doses of ecstasy are more likely to cause lasting harms, such as the permanent brain damage. And they also have unpleasant after effects, especially in people who are using it for the first time. So it's really important to know that if you are taking it for the first time, just take a really, really small dose. Also, I said before that a lot of people feel a feeling of dehydration, and so this would cause people to drink a lot of water. And one of the main side effects of MDMA is that it stops urine, so it has a urine retention, and this could lead to a lot of problems, like for example hyponatremia. So For this, you need to moderate how much you are drinking water. You can have salty snacks, for example, or take isotonic drinks. And it's really important to avoid alcohol because, as I said before, it causes even more dehydration. So, what about tolerance? There are some signs of tolerance of ecstasy. So a lot of people, once they use it regularly, they would need a higher dose to feel the same effect. However, regarding dependence and addiction, ecstasy is known to be less dependent or has less dependence potential and less addictive potential than other drugs. However, also recent studies have shown that in animals, actually in rats, it did cause addiction. And I said before that it works on the neurotransmitters such as serotonin and dopamine, which are, it has the same mechanism of action of other addictive drugs. So this is still debatable. Some thought that it could help with the treatment of PTSD, so post-traumatic stress disorder. However, there are different researchers that showed conflicting results. At present, it cannot be used, so MDMA cannot legally be used in psychotherapy. And more research is needed to explore MDMA's special values and therapeutic aid. So for the med students that really want to explore interesting researches, you can go for this. I'm going to talk about some myths. So I said before that it is as the safe party drug, it is not, and I showed you why. Some people used to think that ecstasy would produce brains, those holes in the brain. It's not true. Also, some people think that the powder form is purer than the pill form. Also, it's not true because they can both be mixed with many different types of drugs. And it was believed that it causes Parkinson's disease, and it doesn't. So, what about the treatment? It's really important to treat someone, or if you know that someone is using ecstasy in an abusive way, it's really important to talk to them, to treat them. This is not because, although it is like it has less dependence potential and addiction potential. The problem with it is that people try to substitute it with other types of drugs that are much more detrimental, such as cocaine, for example. And no specific treatments for MDMA abuse. However, like all the other types of drug abuse, one of the best treatment is cognitive behavior. You have counseling, support groups, etc. Unfortunately, there is no pharmacological treatment for MDMA abuse. However, some people rely on antidepressants. I told you, I talked to you about the Suicide Tuesday. So basically, people use antidepressants to remove those depressive effects. So what about COVID? The American Psychological Association said that the next pandemic we're going to suffer from is a mental health pandemic. And actually, experts are predicting a huge increase in PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. And this type of disorder is highly associated with unhealthy behavior such as alcohol consumption and drug abuse. So it's really important to raise awareness and talk about know what are the things that you're taking and what they are doing to your body. Basically, on Saturday, we're going to release an article that's going to also discuss this topic. So if you want to like learn more about it, you can talk about it. To join LAMSA, you can join on Instagram. So, and we also have every Wednesday, we have ups that discuss different mental health topics and addiction topics. And you can also join our forum where we publish articles every Saturday. And so you would read about really interesting stuff. So, and before I finish, I'm a couple of days late, but I know that we should celebrate women every day. So I'm going to celebrate the amazing ladies that are with us today. And I'm going to take your questions from here. Thank you. I'm going to see if there are questions in the chat. Have I tried it? I haven't. Yeah.
Your presentation, Tatiana.
Thank you. Okay. Percentage of youth use ecstasy. Actually, there's no data in Lebanon. However, there was a recent publication that showed that one third I forgot the university's name. Oh, Stanford. Sorry, I'm sorry. One third of Stanford students have already used it. So, yeah. Do I know why it causes hyponatremia? Actually, can you have presentation in French? Yes, of course. Next time I will have it in French. And also I can release the article in French too, so I would share it. So what do you think about the debate, if it's better to have on-site bill check or not? What do you think about it?
Thank you for your presentation. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Yeah, I think it's like the needle exchange program that they do for opioid users. I think it's a great idea to have stations in areas or concerts that they know people might use it to try to help them and maybe save them. And maybe at the same time, they can try to stop them from taking the drug, like a small form of awareness. And if they are still convinced that they want to take it, at least it will be safe for them.
Yeah, I agree. Good point. Thank you for saying, Gordon. Okay, so is there any other question? Okay, so I'm going to end the meeting. Thank you. Thank you so much for joining, and have a great night.